idea of this afternoon's conversation really, and I'd really like it to be a conversation after a point, is really to trace something that I've been trying in the theatre now over the last maybe 12, 14 years perhaps. My own theatre career is much longer than that. I started when I was about 17, just out of school, and it was, I think, 1974. I was just very, very fortunate to... It's one of those historical accidents that happened that, you know, I was very fortunate to bump into a very, very senior theatre director informally, Mr. Satyadev Dubey. And... which was fine, but what was really fortunate for me was at that point of time he was casting for a play, and he just had a quarrel with one of the actors who he had already cast. So he had thrown her out, and he needed somebody to replace. So this actress was supposed to play a young male, and a famous actress, maybe I should say who it was, Chitra Palekar, that's Amol Palekar's ex-wife, yeah. So Dubey and Chitra fought. He used to fight with a lot of people, with everybody. And he threw her out before the rehearsal started, and he was looking for somebody, and he just happened to remember having briefly been introduced to me at a common friend's house, and I got a call saying that Dubey is looking to cast, would you like to be in his play? And I said, my God, of course I would like to. And I was 17 at that time, and that's how it began. So I spent many years with him. I spent almost 10 years with him studying theatre, working with him. It was not a school in the sense that he went to classes. You know, it was an ongoing theatre company that he ran. So you did and you learned. And with Dubey, you did a lot and you learned a lot. A lot of the learning took place in sleazy bars at night after performances. Long walks at 2 in the morning from Dadar to Santa Cruz. With Dubey, you learned not only about how you conducted rehearsals and how you dealt work with actors, but you also learned how to organize a party after a show, how to hold your drink, all very useful in the theatre, as in life. So it was a very interesting kind of school. But and I just mentioned this one thing, and I won't make it too anecdotal. Studying with Dubey was important in itself, but I think the time in which all this took place was also very, very important in the sense the way it kind of influenced the way I look at theatre and the way I looked at theatre after that. I told you that this happened in the mid to late 70s that I started working with him. And that was a particularly interesting period in the history of our country. Tremendous turmoil. Is this better? Tremendous turmoil. My God, this is very loud. I feel like I'm gonna... Yeah, so the 70s was a slightly difficult time in India. Very exciting, but also a lot of political unrest, social unrest. If you remember that, you know, Jayaprakash Narayan's movement in the north had just sort of, you know, reached its peak, and that's when emergency had been declared in a sense to, you know, bring the country back into some kind of, you know, controlled, regulated way, and that worked very, very against the Congress Party. Then after the emergency, when the emergency was lifted, there was a huge wave of liberation. Many of the people, the political parties and thought that had been banned and had been suppressed during the emergency, then came out on the streets too, because suddenly there was freedom to say what you wanted to say. Among them, for instance, were the Dalit Panthers. And I remember, you know, people like Namdev Dasar and some of the young Dalit leaders at that time who actually shaped the Dalit Panther movement, coming out of the streets and agitating. It was a very, very exciting time. There was great concern for civil liberties. The Committee for the Protection of Democratic Rights was formed. So you can imagine that this was a time, not just in India, but all over the world, that there was a lot of political turmoil, and people were very concerned about the role of the arts in society. Alright? You weren't an artist because you felt like being an artist. You were an artist and you felt a great sense of responsibility that your art needed to mean something. Alright? And I'm not talking about what you would immediately consider, you know, the street theatre, that all theatre has to have a message, has to have a... No, it's not that. It's just that you took your art responsibly, you took it very, very seriously, and you felt you had a social responsibility as an artist, that at the end of the day when someone saw your piece of work, they needed to be in some way challenged, provoked, they needed to have another way of looking at the world around them, they needed to get some insights, you needed to have something to say. Yeah. As an artist, you needed to have something to say. You didn't just do a play because you felt like doing it. Now, this may sound a bit strange in postmodern times, when a lot of art is because I felt like it. It works for me. You know, that's the new way. But my training and my background is actually from another time. So, by the mid-80s, we had started doing our own work. I'd stopped working with Dubey and I started my own theatre company. Arpana was set up in 1985. And for the longest time, we were trying to figure out what we were trying to do with ourselves. When you set up a theatre company, you want to be identified by something. You want to be known for a particular kind of theatre. And it's not easy to define that. It's not easy to define that, especially in theatre, which is a cooperative art form. It's not like a painter or a poet where you work on your own. Or even a solo dancer, you work on your own. Or even musicians are extremely, you know, individualistic because they're the soloists, I mean. Theatre is not like that. Theatre is a cooperative art form. You have to work with many, many different kinds of people. You have to take them along. You have to arrive at some kind of, you know, consensus in what you're doing. I'm not talking about the usual feudal setup where the director is God and then what he or she says. You know, when you form a company, it's more than that. So in the beginning, we kind of figured that, you know, we would present contemporary Indian work in Hindi. There's a lot of very interesting writing in theatre in Marathi. There's a tradition of tremendous playwriting in Marathi. So a lot of the new, younger writers who were writing at that time in Marathi, we translated their plays into Hindi and we performed them. Small audiences, usually Prithvi type places, 200, 180, you know, that kind of thing. Why in Hindi? Because we felt that we could reach out to a larger audience. I was always very, very concerned about not being limited by language in that sense. And Hindi at that time, and this is in the 80s, in Mumbai, was the link language. So, now it's English, but at that time it was Hindi. So, you had audiences from Gujarati coming and watching a Hindi play, you had audiences from Marathi coming and watching a Hindi play. So Hindi was a kind of a common language. So you reached out to a much larger cross-section of the audience across languages. Now it's not like that, it's much more ghettoized. So if I want to cross over, then I have to do a play in Gujarati to reach out to a Gujarati audience, and then I have to do a play in Marathi to reach out to a Marathi audience. The crossoverness has reduced considerably. So for a long time, this is how we defined ourselves, that we do modern Indian theatre, contemporary plays by younger writers, sometimes senior writers, but plays that were strongly rooted in our own cultural tradition, and they in some way reflected the world around us. But this was very much the conventional style. There was a playwright who wrote a play, and then we went to the playwright and said, wow, this sounds really interesting. We feel we can say something through this play. Do we have your permission to do the play? And then the playwright would say, yes, of course. I'll give you the play, and you took the script, and you tried to do something with the script. Right? So it was a given, in a sense. This went on for several years, and I think we were fairly quickly made our mark in the theatre scene. At that time, the theatre scene was not so complex or layered as it is today. Today, there's a much more happening than there was at that time. Around the mid-90s, you know, this kind of drive, kind of, you know, it faded a bit. I think there was a huge change that took place. I think with the whole, you know, opening up of the economy, as it's called, or the, you know, the liberalization, which kind of ushered in the whole consumer trend that we are now so familiar with and we take for granted. It was quite a...
What's happening? The projector?
Yeah. So that was quite a change for us at that time. And suddenly theatre changed. For various reasons, I had kind of dropped out of performing in regular theatre. I'd gone more into working with school students, using theatre as an educational tool, etc., for about 3 or 4 years. And when I came back, I realized that the scenario had changed completely. Theatre had now become yet another product of entertainment, right? So just as you chose to, just as you chose to watch a movie, you also chose to watch a play, and the evening involved watching the play, maybe a dinner after that, or a drink prior or after, was part of an evening. In the earlier time, theatre was seen much more as an artistic form. Okay, so there was a certain degree of kind of, there's a different way of looking at it. And I felt it was fine. I didn't really mind that. I thought it was quite liberating for an audience to be able to just buy a ticket, watch a play and judge it for itself, like any other consumer. That's fine. I have no problem with that. It's good not to place things on pedestals. You know, we have too much of that in India already. You know, that everything is so reverential and, you know, guru-dam driven. Just bullshit. Okay. So in that way, I was very happy that it liberated not just audiences, but also us from this tremendous sense of, you know, carrying Indian culture and stuff like that. But on the other hand, when you become a product of entertainment, then do you please the consumer? Because that's what it is. Do you worry about the bottom line? Because that's what commercialism is about. Do you do what you want to do, regardless of whether it's going to be popular? These are very, very important questions. And the way we do our theatre today in this country is there is very little support for the theatre. Alright, so it's not as though the government is giving you a lot of money, it's not as though corporations are giving you money. Most theatre people, most independent theatre people in this city generate their own funds, they sell tickets, people like you buy those tickets, watch the play, the money that is collected is put into their plays, nobody is paid at market rates, token payments are made, so the entire fraternity subsidizes the theatre work. Okay? If you were to pay a real price for the amount it costs us to do a play, the average ticket price in Bombay would be 500 rupees, at least. Okay? So, you understand that there's this whole system that works, which is essentially flourishes on hidden subsidies. And in this environment, it becomes a huge challenge for theatre people to continue to do the kind of theatre they want to do. Alright? And not necessarily worry about, oh my god, is it going to succeed? And succeed how? Not critically, but is it going to succeed in the box office, etc., etc. So, essentially it means that most of us are not full-time theatre people, in the sense that we do other jobs to support ourselves. I've been doing many, many things. Fortunately, for the last 4 or 5 years, I've been able to only do theatre, which is very, very fortunate. But among the many things that I did for a living was also making documentary films. From school, I've always been extremely interested in history. I've been studying of history. I didn't pursue it in college because, you know, I was in college during the emergency and all our classrooms were on the streets and not in the college classrooms. So, didn't really, you know, spend too much time worrying about studies in college. But in school, I was extremely interested in history, and that interest in history continued when Mr. Shanbag was doing a television series called Bharat Ek Khoj, which was basically the history of India seen through the eyes of Jawaharlal Nehru. Discovery of India is a very famous book. So we did a huge history series, 54 hours of Indian history, and I was one of the few people who wrote that series. So I was very interested in history. And documentary cinema allowed me to play with sociology, anthropology, politics, environmentalism. Documentary filmmakers are a bit like journalists. You know, we're generalists. We can become experts very quickly on something by reading up a few things and quickly understanding what the main issue is at stake. But I used to always keep these two lives separate. My life as a documentary filmmaker and my life as a theatre person. Somehow I didn't want the two worlds to mix. But after I came back into theatre after that long layoff, I felt that perhaps it was time to bring those two worlds together. And the opportunity came when there was a very interesting play being written, and I heard about it by a friend of mine who was also a colleague. I heard that this young man, Ramu Ramanathan, was actually putting together a play that talked about the history of the mill workers in Mumbai. Right? And being in Bombay, I've always felt that somehow our theatre has never reflected working class history of this city, in a sense. I don't know if you'll agree with me, all of us are extremely proud of this city for many reasons, but one of the reasons is that we always say that yeah, India mein ek hi shehar hai, proper shehar hai, Bombay hai. Everybody else is just a village that's overgrown, right? And what is it about Bombay that makes it comparable to, say, a New York or to any major urban center anywhere in the world? And I believe that Bombay is Ladakh because of a very strong working class history and tradition in this city, which therefore forces it to be a more democratic space. So Delhi, being a capital like most capitals in the world, will tend to be a little more feudal and old-fashioned. All right. Chennai is really struggling to find its definition as a city. Calcutta is one, but it's Calcutta is something completely different. It's another city altogether. But this city is the one place where everybody sees themselves with a tremendous sense of dignity in what they do. So whether it is the top-notch CEO of a company, or it's an auto rickshaw driver, or it's the guy who makes pav bhaji on the street, everybody sees themselves as a professional. It's not just the way they hold themselves, but it's also the way they carry out their work. It's a great sense of dignity. You can't mess around with these guys. Just because you're wearing a suit and a tie, you can't boss over them, right? Unlike other cities in this country. Now you'll understand the point I'm trying to make. And this is possible in this city because of a very strong working class history. This is a city, a manufacturing center, and great number of workers in the population living in this very interesting city next to you. Very few, bit of segregation in the city, very few gated communities in the city. So you're forced to live cheek by jowl, you're forced to travel in the same transport, etc., etc., which Delhi incidentally just discovering thanks to the metro. And it's the most fascinating thing for a Mumbai person to travel by Delhi metro, because you can see the tension in the air when the classes are being mixed there, okay, on those trains. Air conditioning, you know, doesn't really help there. So, when I heard that Ramu was doing this, writing this play on the working class history of the city, of the textile mills, such an important part of the city, I was immediately interested. And he followed a very interesting process where it's basically written out of long interviews with workers, with their families, with sociologists, with political scientists, with economists. He has kind of put this play together. And I was not really involved in the process of writing the play, but once the play came to hand, then we realized very quickly that this is not just another production that one can do straight off. We need to work on it. We need to really add layers to this play in order to do justice to it. So it began with the way we cast the play. It was decided that we do it in Hindi, not in Marathi. Though Marathi was the natural language of the play, but we said no, we do it in Hindi because it needs to reach out to a larger audience. But the language should not be North Indian Hindi. It has to be Hindi as with a Marathi syntax. Alright? So Ramu wrote this play in English and we needed to translate it. So we found a very, very talented writer, Chetan Datar, who unfortunately is no more, died very young, prematurely. So Chetan is a Marathi writer, playwright and a director in his own right, but knew enough Hindi. So I told him, Chetan, write the play in Hindi, but imagine that you're writing it in Marathi. Write it with the Marathi syntax. So that's what he did. And it was a very, very different color to the language. In fact, years later, a lot of people remember having seen Cotton 56 as a Marathi play and not as a Hindi play. And they often ask me, when did you do the Hindi version? And I said, there was never an original Marathi, it was always in Hindi. So language and how you translate also becomes very important. But it was really important for us to get the cast to understand what they were performing, because there was a great sense of responsibility to this subject and to the people who we were representing and the history that we were representing. So the cast spent time in the labor court, looking at what was happening with mill workers. Now, in early 2000, when we did this play, this was the time when there was a major tussle going on between the owners of the mills and the workers that they had laid off or were about to lay off. Because the land on which the mills stood was now much more valuable than the mills themselves or anything that the mills could produce. You know, the mills had lost out because, well, there's a long story to this and there's tremendous politics to this, but one of the critiques is that a lot of the money that was made in the mills was never put back in upgrading the technology. You know, so the money was put into other businesses. That was one of the critiques. The other historical thing was that with technology developing rapidly, power looms started coming up and a lot of cloth was being produced in the, not in the organized sector. So you had places like Bhiwandi, on the outskirts of the city producing cloth, which was half the price of mill cloth. So you couldn't really compete with that. So it was a kind of an end game situation anyway. But slowly, with the land becoming so important to the mill owners, they were all in a hurry to shut down the mills, lay off the workers, and sell the land. And as happens, the mafia gets involved, and this was the time of the big gangs in the city. So, you know, the Gaulis and everybody was part of the scene. And there were court cases. And one by one, as we were rehearsing this play, the mill workers were losing their cases in court. Okay. And it was a very, very difficult situation for them. And that was when we were actually creating this play. So it gave us a tremendous sense of being very connected to what was going on in the city at that time. It became very, very relevant and very vital. It sort of made us feel very alive to what was happening, and that we were in some way representing living history. How do we look at history? Interestingly, how do the authorities look at history? Now, Mumbai and Maharashtra and Gujarat, which were earlier part of the Bombay Presidency, are the only two states in this country which have a censor board for the stage. So we have something called the Stage Scrutiny Board. So anything that is performed live, whether it's a song or a tamasha or a you know, play, has to be pre-censored. Okay, so we have to submit our scripts to them, they look at it, and then they decide, somebody decides whether this is fit to be played before the public. Alright? Interesting, no? The only two cities in this, two states in this country that hold on to this. And this comes under the police, mind you, doesn't even come under any civilian authority. This is directly under the police. Right? So the police give us licenses and permissions. So when this script was sent, they said, oh, you can't use Mr. Bal Thackeray's name. Because, you know, Bal Thackeray, the Shiv Sena, played a very, very important part. Shiv Sena was created by the Communist Party, for those who don't know, to suppress the mill workers' unions, which were communist unions. Right? In much the way what happened in Punjab later on with Bindranwale. Right? The Communist Party never learned from its mistakes. Right? So they created the Shiv Sena here, and the Shiv Sena's essential fundamental job was to break the mill unions. So there were obviously references to historical incidents and historical characters, and the censor board said, no, you cannot use these names. Why? Because they are living historical figures. Right? So this is the kind of resistance there is to contemporary history being actually played out. So the same thing in an encyclopedia, in a book is fine, in a film is also fine, but somehow theatre is seen as a subversive form, somehow it's seen as very powerful. Anyway, so the play opened, and it was very important for me. My theatre is very, very, in terms of design, is very bare. I depend a lot on actors, the text, and to build a performance. I don't use a lot of sets. But while doing this play, I was very keen that the audience was always enveloped by a sense of the space where the mill stood. I don't know if the younger people remember this, but many of you will remember that driving down Tulsi Pipe Road, you drove through the heart of the mill area, which today is, you know, glass towers and everything has changed. It's become a service industry. So that was, and then the area was called Girangaon, right? The village of mills. So there was a certain kind of feel in that area, and it was very important for me to get that feel. So we decided to actually create a beautiful painted backdrop that depicted that, and I'll show you pictures of that. So that you always, as an audience, felt that you were in the middle of that space. As I said, the play opened, and despite, you know, warnings and sort of, you know, people said that this is going to create a bit of a, you know, controversy, you're talking about historical figures, etc., etc. In fact, it did well. A lot of young people who live in the city said to us that, well, this play for us gave us an idea of what the city means, what we are part of. A lot of young people who are migrants in the city, who have come to do jobs in the city, came and said, well, it gave us an understanding of our city that we have adopted. But I think the strongest feedback we got was from this young lady who called the morning after she had seen the play. She'd seen the play the night before at 3, and the next morning she went to work and she called me, somebody I know, an acquaintance. And she said, you know, I never realized what the textile mills meant to this city and how important they were to this city. And this morning when I was driving into work in Parel, the gateway to my office block said Raghuvanshi Mills. And suddenly I realized that my office block has been built where once a cotton textile mill stood. And she made that connect for herself between the present and the past and what these mills meant to the city, what this history of the city was. And I think as theatre people, that for us was, extremely heartening, because I don't think that theatre can do much more than actually make connections for people, can give people different ways of seeing what is otherwise, around them normally. So I'll just take you through some of the images of, if I can get my computer to work now. Oh, the projector's on the screen. So this is the play, Cotton 56, Polyester 84. A strange title for those who haven't seen the play. The play is about two retired mill workers who hang around outside their chawl at a sarvajanik vachanalaya. You know what a sarvajanik vachanalaya is? You know the corner newspapers are put. They hang around there all day because they have nothing to do. And they talk about their past, tell stories about their past. And people who pass on the road, depending on what cloth they are wearing, there is a little game. So one of them prefers cotton, the other prefers polyester. So it's a game. So 56 cotton and polyester 84. So obviously polyester wins, right? So we use that as the title of the play. This is the poster of the play. This is Girangaon, the old Girangaon. This is the old mills, an old mill building. This was a familiar landscape at one point in central Bombay. And these are the chawls where the mill workers live. These are chawls, actually the Bombay chawls were created as housing for mill workers. And a lot of literature has been written around the chawl. Kula Deshpande, some of his most famous plays come out of these chawls. These are the old chawls, you're not going to see them for very much longer. In fact, most of these have been broken down now for towers. A great part of Bombay's history, architectural history is sort of being, these are more modern chawls. So while we were looking at this backdrop and what kind of aesthetic to use in this backdrop, started looking at the works of this painter, Sudhir Patwardhan, one of the few painters who actually paints working class, scenes. These are some of Sudhir's paintings, as you can see, the Bombay local train. Look at the kind of people in his paintings, simple, ordinary, working class people. The kind of landscapes, the almost frontier-like landscape of an industrial area, wasteland, shanty towns, slums, buildings. Here's another view of his paintings. And this painting caught my fascination. I really got very interested in this because it had several elements. It had the street level, it had these old buildings, this old construction, the old bridge, stone that you still see in some parts of Bombay, the mills behind it, and in the back, the new buildings coming up, the towers coming up. So this kind of layering was very, very interesting. And this is the backdrop we created. But we distorted it to make it more tense. Didn't make it realistic, It was distorted. So everything is moving at an angle.
Skyscrapers,
flyover, mill in the, the mill in the foreground, the little chai ka thela, the cycle. But as you go up, the new city starts looming over you. Right. It was also used in the poster design, and it was painted on a curtain, and you can see it in the backdrop. Now you can see it better. So this is a painted curtain. It's 40 feet across and 16 feet high. And there's a little story about how this was painted. So Vivek Zadha, the designer, he actually painted it on a piece of paper, which is the first song. And we went, and there are professional backdrop painters, okay, who do sets for theatre, etc. So we went to one of them, but he said, where will I hang something that's 40 feet across and 16 feet high in this city? So he hired the back space of a theater in Parel, and he laid it on the floor, and he did it in sections, okay, because there was no way he could lay out the whole thing. And I remember while he was painting it that we could never see it in entirety. We could only see a section 6 feet by whatever, you know, 16 feet. You could never see the whole thing. So when he was putting it up, there was a moment when you didn't know whether it's going to work. Like you've never seen it all up together. So while they were placing it, this is hung at Prithi, this is at Prithi Theatre, so this is on the Cyclora. I left the theatre, I couldn't take the tension. And I said, when it's done, call me in. It costs a lot of money. So I told these guys when they were painting, is come and see the play. You might, you know, you painted this beautiful backdrop. You'd like to see what the play is about. And he said, there's no reason for us to see the play. I said, why? He said, see, we are retired mill workers ourselves. We lost our jobs, so we took to painting sets. And your backdrop tells the story of the entire play. We don't need to see the play. So that was how evocative it was for them. Right? So this is one of you. These are the characters of the play. That's the Vachanalaya where they sit and read the newspapers. And these are the two friends. This is the wife of the mill worker. This is the son on the right who decides that, you know, working in the mill is not half as exciting as becoming a gangster. Because that was when a lot of young people in that working class area of central Bombay were being lured by the gangs to work as shooters, basically the cannon fodder. So this was very common in lower middle class Maharashtra families, that the younger ones would get tempted and lured. So he is part of that. This play has been performed all over the country in open air spaces. This is in this is at Bandra. This is in Indore, which is also a cotton manufacturing center. You can see the cotton mill chimney still in the background. Difficult in open air spaces with the wind. In Nagpur we were performing, and this is how people, you know, you think the theater is not a mainstream activity, that cinema attracts much bigger audiences. So theater's impact shouldn't be as powerful as cinema, but there's something about live art that the authorities fear hugely. Okay. We were performing in Nagpur and suddenly the power was cut and police vans came into the campus. You can see that the police, an armed police, surrounded us and said your performance cannot take place. And we said, why, what's the problem? They said, no, we have reports that this is a Nakshalite play.
How much?
So we said, it is not such a play, it is a political play, certainly. It's about political history of this country, of our city, but it's not a Nakshalite play. It's about mill workers. They said, no, we have information. We are refusing permission to do this play. So there's a little notice we had to put up saying that the police have not allowed us to do this play. But there were 800 people who had bought tickets to see the show. And there they are waiting to see the show. So what do we do? So we said, okay, we shouldn't disappoint the audience. Let's meet in a nearby small hall, which is probably 1/4 the size of this hall, or even less. And let's talk about what we were to do and, you know, engage in a conversation. And of course, the money was refunded, but, you know, there's a disappointment. So we went off to this hall. You can see how small it is. And we had no costumes, but we had the musicians, because I use a lot of live music. We had the musicians. And I said, let's start performing. Let's see what happens. And we performed the play in that space, that little dali out there with an audience. And it was wonderful because they just loved watching the show. And for us, as actors who, you know, who are very, very interested in performing, and for us, the most important thing in our lives is to perform. It was not a disappointment. We managed to connect, we performed. Also, it goes to show that at the end of the day, theatre can be performed anywhere. It doesn't necessarily need a stage, etc. Especially if it is meaningful and relevant theatre. So yeah, so, you know, that was Cotton 56. I mentioned Dubai to you. So, a few years later, Prithvi Theatre did a festival in which they dedicated the whole festival to Dubai and his work. And because I had worked so closely with Dubey, they said, will you do a, you know, 1 or 2 hour opening live show for the festival that kind of presented Dubey and his work. So I was just thinking about, you know, that Dubey came to Bombay in the early 60s as a young man and was working continuously and very profoundly all the way into the late 90s. So is it possible to trace the history of theatre in Bombay with Dubey's personal journey? Can we do a kind of a parallel thing? Because he's been around for so long and his theatre was so influential. So we did that, and we used a lot of old material, archival photographs, film footage. We got old actors of his, actors who had worked with him in his first few productions to come and talk about the experience. So it was a kind of a evening, a 2 hour long evening, which was, it had video, it had performances, scenes from his plays, it had actors talking about him. And it was very interesting because a lot of young theatre people who saw the show said that for the first time they understood what they were part of, a long tradition of theatre. We don't have a way of communicating traditions in this country, you know, because we hardly write, everything is oral. So if you're lucky to meet somebody who will tell you what history, great. Otherwise, you have to figure it out for yourself. Or you believe that what you're doing in the moment is in itself, you know, separate from what happened before and what will happen in the future. So a lot of young people came and said in the theatre that now we understood where we fit in the history of theatre. And that got me thinking. I said, if we can do this kind of an approach, if we can use this kind of an approach with an individual, how about if we did it with an idea? And you know by now that, you know, one of the ideas that I was kind of obsessing over at that time was the idea of censorship. And this was also a time when, like in the current time, we had a right-wing government in power, and painters were being attacked, and, you know, poets were being attacked, and faces were being blackened, and shows of plays were being shut down because they, in some obscure way, affected the sensibilities of people, of communities, etc. So I said, let's talk about censorship. Can I do a play on censorship itself? And look at it through theatre history. And if you talk about censorship in the theatre in Maharashtra, then the one play that comes to mind is a very famous play by a very famous writer, Vijay Tendulkar, called Sakharam Binder. Okay, some of you may have heard the name Sakharam Binder. So this was a play written in the early 70s, first performed in 1972, tells the story of Sakharam, who's a working class man, who's a bookbinder by profession, hence binder, who lives in a little house outside the city, on the outskirts of the city, and who refuses to toe the line, the social norms of society. So what he does is he goes to the nearby bus stop and he picks up destitute women, women he sees who have been abandoned, thrown out of the house, whatever, who have no shelter. He invites them to stay in his house. He says, I will give you a roof, I will give you 2 saris a year, food to eat, alright? But the deal is that you have to live here as my wife. And it's a contract. If I am fed up with you, I give you notice and you leave. If you are fed up with me, you give me a notice and you leave. This is our relationship. I don't care for the hypocrisy of marriage. I don't care for the hypocrisy of relationships as defined by normal society. This was what the play was about. So you can imagine in 1972 when it was staged, there was huge controversy. And so ironic that 70s was a period of liberation. This was the alternative cinema movement in India was at its peak at that time. All over the world, rules were being broken. The hippies ruled the world, hippie culture ruled the world, etc., etc. But you also had a backlash from conservative sections of society. So Sakharam Binder was attacked. The censor board refused to give it permission. It was taken to court. The case was fought. The case was won. And the play continued to be performed. So it's an amazing story of a play that has been hit by censorship, but where they had the courage to fight. And what was interesting is that Kamalakar Sarang, the director of the play, maintained a day-by-day diary of what was going on during that period. And it's published in Marathi. It's called Binder Chitivas in Marathi. It's a very interesting book for those of you who might be interested in theatre history. Now, it's rare in India that you find this kind of documentation. So, to me, it seemed absolutely perfect to look at the idea of censorship using the story of Sakharam Binder. So So I started talking to two writers, one very senior writer, Shanta Gokhale, who is herself a writer, critic, but somebody who has been watching theatre for so long that she understands patterns that have taken place in theatre. And she was immediately excited with the idea. We also got in a younger writer, Iravati Karnik, who was much more into researching and finding out things. So this was a good combination. And Shanta suggested, she said that, you know, there is something called state censorship, which is the state censorship board, as I was saying. But there is also censorship by society. And, you know, theatre people who live in cities have access to courts and to lawyers and they can fight. But what happens to smaller traditions like folk forms? And she introduced the idea that if you look at tamasha, you know, in Maharashtra there is a very famous popular folk form called tamasha. Look at the history of what happened to tamasha. So tamasha was created as a form of entertainment in the camps of the soldiers of the Peshwas. Alright? So it was for the entertainment of soldiers. So it was loud, it was sexual, okay, it was irreverent, okay. But it became very popular. So the Peshwas said, okay, let's invite this into our court. But they told the tamasha performers that, listen, now our women will be watching this, so you please tone down all that sex and all that, okay? Because our women can't watch all this. So the tamasha performers were so happy anyway to be invited to perform in the court, they said, okay, we'll tone it down. And so that was the first form of censorship that took place to this form that was otherwise so vibrant and so vigorous. Then independence happened, right? And post-independence, of course, as a country, we were rediscovering our own folk forms and our own classical performing traditions. So urban Maharashtra decided that we have to revive tamasha and lavani, right? And we should be now performed in the cities and we should all as families go and watch it. And they said, no, but we are middle class people. We don't want all this shaking of hips and, you know, all this, you know, sarcasm and all this sort of, you know, satire. Okay, we just want clean song and dance. So tamasha got further sanitized. Alright? So Shanta pointed out that here is a tradition that over a period of 200 years has lost its vigor. And today most tamasha is danced with film songs. Okay? Has lost its vigor. Why don't we juxtapose these two stories? One of Sakharam Binder and one of the tamasha. Okay? Complex. So that's what we did. And we created a play called Sex, Morality and Censorship. Alright? The image you see is of a lavani dancer. The images in the background are of the original play Sakharam Binder. Right? So we tried to recreate the story of Sakharam Binder's struggle. We also did scenes from Sakharam Binder, the play, on stage so that you could understand why people objected to it or why it shook up society so much. But we also recreated what was going on in theatre, in cinema at that time, in advertising at that time. So you understand that in what context these things were being done. Why was this play so powerful at a time where everything else around it was very, very hypocritical, very romantic. So suddenly a realistic play creates something. So it became very important for us to place the play in a certain context, to place the idea of censorship in a context and not just talk about it as an abstraction. Right? So this is one of the original titles. Ads of the play, that's Neeru Dhune, and that's Kamlakar's wife, Lalan Saran, who played Champa, the most powerful character in this play. These are the ads of the play. If you can read them, you know, you talk about the court giving permission for two more shows, three more shows, etc. And there was, of course, a lot of talk in the newspapers at that time because of the... At that time, you know, people were actually concerned about freedom of speech, etc. So there was, you know, editorials written. At best of times, censors in India are unpredictable lot. Doesn't it look like yesterday's newspaper? Sakharam Binder. Art and authority have always been in conflict. Intellectuals resent attack on Binder. This is 13 March 1973. Long live censors, the satirical piece of the censor board. The Maharashtra government actually took the case to the Supreme Court. Yeah. Okay, this looks like yesterday's headline. SS is Shiv Sena, prevent staging of Sakharam Binder. So, ironical, they started attacking this play, alright? So what does Kamalakar Saran do? He's fed up because he's put a lot of money into this play and he's going at a loss. Can't do performances. So he says, Mr. Thackeray, would you like to see the play and decide for yourself whether it is a problem play? Right? Now Tendulkar, who had written the play, was aghast. He said, how can you invite Bal Thackeray to see the play? Why are you giving in to the same people who are attacking you? And Kamalakar said, you won't understand, Mr. Tendulkar. I have to do this because I'm a businessman also and my play has to survive. So Bal Thackeray sees the play and says, it's fine, there's no problem. Stop attacking this play. And the play does 500 shows. SSG. Interesting, right? For the same, in modern times, you'd have to pay a lot of money. Yeah. So this is the Lavani dancer who is telling the story. These are scenes from the play. This was the time when this play was being done, when John Lennon and Yoko Ono were in bed, anti the Vietnam War. There were anti-Vietnam protests all over the world. Bob Dylan wrote some of his most powerful music. Che Guevara was a popular icon. Mao Zedong and the Long March, Cultural Revolution. This is symbols of nationalism in Calcutta at that time. Naxalwadi. These are images of that time. These are images from our play. These are scenes from the play itself. So you can see the video in the background. That's all archival stuff at that time. Yeah. So this is a second play where I use history in a different way in order to communicate an idea. How will we do for time? Yeah? Alright. So then just one more play then?
Yeah?
Alright. A few years later, a very interesting theatre festival that happens in Calcutta. It's a private festival run by a group of people who are extremely close to Tagore's writings, and they feel very, very strongly that Tagore needs to be re-looked at, needs to be reinterpreted by younger people. For the longest time, the entire copyright for Tagore were resting with Vishwabharati, the university that he set up, and they were extremely territorial and proprietorial about his works. But when the required number of years had passed and Tagore's work came out in the common domain and that monopoly was broken, this group of people felt that now is the time when we should make Tagore popular all over again. So they created this theatre festival where they invited theatre people, dancers, musicians to interpret Tagore in any way they felt like. You were given a completely clean chip, meaning you, there were no restrictions. So they asked me to do a Tagore play for this festival. And I was in the middle of another production at that time and I said yes, and they said, oh, but which play are you going to do? You're going to tell us that quickly. And you know, Tagore's body of writing is huge. It's huge. I mean, he was prolific. But I had memory of having done Dark Earth in school as a student. And I played a little character in that. And I said, without thinking hard, I said, ah, that's interesting. I want to do Dark Earth. Okay, and I stopped thinking about it. And then 2 months later, when it was time for me to start working on the play, as I'm thinking about it, I said, oh my God, why did I say Dark Earth? Because Dark Earth has been done by everybody. The greatest theatre directors of Bengal have never done Dark Earth, Shambhu Mitra. Tagore himself acted in a production of Dark Earth. What am I going to do that is going to make Dark Earth different from what everybody else had done? And you know, all directors have an ego. We always want to be different, right? So, okay, now I'm going to do it. So, also, you know, Tagore's writings now, if you read them, they're a bit romantic, they're very soft, it's very hard to understand, they seem a little out of date. How do you contemporize it? How do I make it relevant to today's audience? So I started reading about the play and trying to figure out, you know, what was the nature of the play, when it was written, what kind of an impact it had on people, blah, blah, blah. And while reading, I came across an incident that happened in 1942 in Warsaw in Poland that blew my mind. I read it and I just went cold, my hair stood on end, and I said, I found the way to do this play. And what was this incident? So, in the 40s in Poland, there was a very famous pediatrician, Polish pediatrician called Janusz Korczak.
And he was very radical, very revolutionary. And this was a time when in Polish society, upper class children were seen, heard and not to be seen. So mothers would have wet nurses to feed their children. Children were kept in the inside room, looked after nannies, etc., etc. And in lower class society in Poland, children were on the street, often physically or emotionally abused. So you had these two extremes. So essentially, children did not have a very great place in society, either way. Into this scene came Korczak, and he said, no, the child is the center of society. So he would tell rich women, your breast belongs to your child. Come on, feed your child. Okay, he would say that, and radical stuff for that. And he became extremely popular, quite fashionable among upper classes. They would invite him to talk to them about how to bring up children. And he had many, many theories about how children should be brought up. He had great faith in children. So he set up an orphanage where he put into practice some of his theories. He was Jewish, so he had Jewish orphans in his orphanage. And these children did things like they ran a newspaper, which was so good that the local daily newspaper made it a weekly supplement of the main newspaper. They had an open parliament where they took decisions democratically for the orphanage, the rules were laid down, and Korczak, all the old elders had to fit in with the same rules that the children created. So you can imagine, it was a very radical space, the children were extremely bright. But that's when Nazi Germany invaded Poland and took over Warsaw. And all the Jews, including Korczak and his orphans, were moved into the Warsaw ghetto. Okay, all of us know what the ghettos were, right? They were parts of the city that were sealed off by high walls within which the Jews were imprisoned. They had no rights, they lived there. It's one of the worst, you know, effects of Nazism in Europe. So Korczak found himself in the orphanage with these children. And they were getting bored, there was not enough food, there was no activity, their morale was going down. But worse than all that was, rumors were being spread now that there is death in the air. That people, the Nazis are putting people into these railway wagons, taking them to some strange place and killing them, and they never come back. This was before the concentration camps became public knowledge. And Korczak always believed that children should always be prepared for what is going to happen to them. So even if you were to see a play in which there was a sudden, you know, event, a dramatic moment, you prepare the child that something like this will happen. He didn't want children to be surprised in that way. So he said, I have to prepare these children for the idea of death, because death is in the air. So what does he do? He decides to do a small production of Tagore's Dark Ghar with the children. Right? Why Dark Ghar? Dark Ghar, for those of you who don't know, is the story of Amal, a little boy who's very ill, who's being brought up by his uncle, who's very old-fashioned, old-school, who has a doctor who's also equally old-fashioned, and the doctor says, if this child has to survive, no fresh air for him, he has to be locked in a room, away from sunlight, away from fresh air, and then he'll get better. So this lovely, bright, curious child, who's about 12 years old, Amal, is locked in this room. And all he has is a window overlooking a street, and people are passing by, and he has conversations with everybody who passes. And he can see the fields, he can see the hills, he can see the world he wants to be part of, but he's locked up here. And a post office is being built down the road, and a slightly cruel, cynical village headman tells him that that post office belongs to the king, and the king is going to send you a letter. So you wait, your letter is going to come. So this little boy is expecting this letter, which is a joke. No letter is going to come. And he's growing frailer and iller as he goes by, he's more and more ill. And by the end of the play, this little boy dies. Alright? Korczak had read this play. And he said, my children need to do this play to understand death, to engage with the idea of death. So they rehearsed this play and they performed it in the ghetto in their little space. There are eyewitness accounts that I have read of people who saw the performance, and people say that for that brief moment we felt that we had been liberated from the ghetto. Right? Children were ill the night before, it was a mess, but they performed it. 8 days later, the order was given that with 20,000 other Jews in the ghetto, Korczak and his orphans were to be taken away. So, again, eyewitnesses talk about the scene in Warsaw that morning. These thousands of Jews are being taken to the railway station. The wagons are waiting to take them away to their death. Many of them are screaming and crying and wailing, right? Because they know they're going to come back. But Korczak and his 16 or 17 or 20 young kids are holding a flag. One of the children is playing a violin and they're marching with their heads held high and singing a song because they are prepared for the idea of death. In their last moments, Dark Ghar has given them dignity. I read this and I said, oh my God.
Wow.
Oh my God. This changes what Dark Ghar means. Not just to me, but if I can do this successfully, it changes the way it means. So I did a play called Walking to the Sun, which was essentially, we took artistic liberty, and the stage is in two parts. In the background, you see the high walls of the concentration camp, the barbed wire. One is a cell, one is a room with a bed, and Korczak is pushed into the cell by a Nazi guard. So we imagine that they've been taken to the concentration camp, and he's been separated from the children before they're put to their death, and he's pushed into the cell. On the other side of the stage, the door opens, and this little boy is gently pushed into the bedroom by his uncle, and they're the two prisoners, one in Dark Ghar and one in the concentration camp. And we see a parallel story of what is going on. So you see the story of Korczak, you see the story of Amal going in parallel, and at some point you realize that the Dark Ghar that you're watching is actually the same play that the kids on the orphanage performed. Right? The attempt was to bring these two worlds together. So let me just show you, this is what it was called, Walking to the Sun. That's Tamo, that's Korczak. Interesting similarities. Yeah, there's Korczak with the children. This is an archival photograph. He just loved children. This is a monument even today in Warsaw. Among the Jewish community, Korczak is a very big icon, huh? Even today. In Europe especially. So, this is the way we saw it. This is the concentration camp. So, here is Korczak being pushed into the cell by a German guard. Yeah, if the lights were not on, you would have seen it. But anyway. And there's Amal in his little room. And the characters that Amal meets outside the window. So now this gives you an idea, right, of the two sides of the stage. And at one point, in the space in between, the two worlds come together. This child is fascinated by this man is fascinated by the child, and then they play games, they speak with each other, and at the end of the play, we realize that they are all the orphans, and they are taken away to the concentration camp and killed. So that was Walking to the Sun. Didn't do many performances of this show, unfortunately, for various reasons. But this was another example of how it was possible, in a way, to place a play in some kind of historical context where it takes on new meanings. Okay, and this is what I mean, that as a director, as a theatre maker, this is perhaps the most important thing for me, isn't it? What do we bring to a piece of work? What do we bring to a moment in history? How can we use theatre to illuminate our times? How can we help an audience suddenly see the same world afresh? And that's what I believe is what my theatre would like to do. Yeah. So yeah, I think we have some time for answer Q&A.
Sir,
yeah.
Can you talk about Shakespeare drama?
Huh? Of course.
And your current one?
That's the current one.
Mera P.A.
Yep, that's the one. Okay, here we go. So, I'm all ready for it. Okay, alright. Can I just stand up and walk now since I'm holding this mic like a rock star? By the Shakespeare Globe Theatre in London. You know, the Shakespeare Globe is this beautiful theatre that was built in the style of Shakespeare's theatres by an American actor, in fact, Sam Wanaker. He decided that, you know, they needed to build this building in the same architectural style as the Globe Theatre that Shakespeare used to work in. So they built it there, and it sits on the banks of the Thames River, very beautiful space. And they said, as a curtain raiser to the London Olympics, we are going to do a huge theatre festival where all 37 of Shakespeare's plays will be done in 37 different languages from 37 countries, right? Then it became 36 countries because they had two productions from India. We were given the privilege of that. So, would you like to do, you know, one of the plays? And I said, yeah, I'd love to do that. It's quite an honor to be invited by the Globe to do a play. It's not easy to get to the Globe. So they said, will you do All Is Well That Ends Well? Which is not one of Shakespeare's better plays. I was a bit disappointed. I wanted to do Taming of the Shrew or something more, you know, dramatic. But all the plays had been taken by people, or they were already productions that they had chosen. So they said, no, no, you do All Is Well That Ends Well. And then, we'd like you to do it in Gujarati. Because we have a huge Gujarati population in England that we all know. And none of them ever come to the Globe. So if there is a play in Gujarati, then, you know, some of them will come back again after having seen this play. And it's part of the audience building exercise. So I said, fine, because, you know, Gujarati is not a problem. I've worked in Gujarati before, and I'm always excited to work in different languages. So, All Is Well That Ends Well, for those of you who don't know, it's a story, it's a very simple story. It's not even a comedy. It's part of Shakespeare's comedy, but it's actually quite black. It's quite grim, this play. It's about Bertram, this young man who is, you know, lives in provincial France in a small town, and in an aristocratic family. And the family has adopted this young girl, Helena, who's the daughter of a, you know, healer. So she's lower class, and there's a countess, his mother, and the father has died. So their uncle, who's the king of France, invites the young man to come to Paris to be part of his court in order to support the family. So Bertram is very excited. He wants to go to Paris. He doesn't realize that Helena is deeply in love with him. So he goes to Paris. Helena is very strong. She says, I'm not going to let him just get away like that. She understands that the king of France suffers from piles, and she has the means to cure that. So she arrives in Paris to the court, cures the king, and in return asks for the hand of Bertram. And Bertram says, what the hell, I don't want to get married to you. But the king says, sorry, she's cured, you're going to get married to this guy. So they get married. And a very reluctant Bertram gets married, and he ditches her, and he goes away to Florence to fight a war there, some minor war. He goes away, abandons Helena. Helena is not to be deterred, she follows him to Florence, and discovers that he has fallen in love, or he's attracted sexually by this young lady, Diana. So she goes to Diana and says, well, you know, let's cheat this guy. Bertram has laid some conditions, he says to Helena. He says, if you ever want me to be your husband, in fact, then what you have to do is to, you know, get my ring and carry my child. But since I'm never going to sleep with you, you cannot have, you know, you never meet these conditions. So there's a scene where the, you know, there's a switch happens in the night. Bertram thinks he's making love to Diana, but Helena takes her place. So, you know, she'd like to be able to meet those conditions, blah, blah, blah. So Helena almost comes across as some kind of a stalker, you know, very dark. And Bertram is such a stupid character that most people say that why would such a smart girl like Helena ever fall in love with Bertram? Right? So this is the play that was presented to me, and I had to produce it in Gujarati. And since we were going to do only two performances in London, we had to have a life before the London performances and after the London performances, which meant that it had to play to Gujarati audience. How many of you see Gujarati plays here? Okay, fair number. So Gujarati theatre, as you know, mostly is very popular theatre, mostly comedies. It's what is known as commercial theatre. Who's interested in watching a Shakespeare play in Gujarati? Right? When this curtain opens, you want to see a big set, you want to see a comedy, etc. So I had to find a way of making it interesting to a Gujarati audience. So we said, let's set the play in 1900 in Saurashtra and Mumbai. So Bertram became Bharat Ram. This young man in a village, Zamindar family, Bhatiyas, okay? Helena became Haley, the young daughter of a physician, you know, naturopath. And Bertram's, Bharatram's uncle was not the king,
but became Gokuldas Savaram Bhatia, a very big trader in Bombay. In 1900, Bombay was a very flourishing port city, and there was huge opium trade, trade in oil, trade in precious stones, with cloth, etc. And the Bhatias were a very powerful community in part of that trade. So he becomes that. He invites Bharat Ram to come and join his trade in Bombay. Haley follows him. Gokuldas Bhatia has TB, she cures him of TB, gets Bharat Ram, etc. So what we did in effect was we played the history of the Gujarati community, in a sense, before them as a play. Right? So you went to watch this play, and of course you followed the storyline and it had its humor and all that kind of thing. But you suddenly said, oh my god, that's my great-grandfather's story, or my great-grand-uncle's story. Because this is exactly what happened to him. He came from Saurashtra to Bombay with just 30 rupees in his pocket. He made it as a trader here. He made a big trade. Then he traded with the West, he traded with China, he traded with the Southeast Asia. Okay. Suddenly there was a connect between the play and the audience. It became their play because it was revealing their history. And stylistically, I wanted to find a form where I could use live music. And I also know that, you know, in the 1900s, there was a form of theatre that was very popular among Gujaratis called the Bhangwadi Theatre. Again, for those of you who know a little bit of Gujarati theatre history, it was a style of theatre characterized by very beautiful painted curtains, song, live song, and dance, and very, very fantastic stories. Then, of course, as it went along, there were social themes, there were mythological themes, etc. So I used the Bhangwadi style of storytelling, of playing, and that's how Maro Piyu Gayo Rangoon, because Bharat Ram leaves Bombay and goes to Rangoon to train, and Rangoon was a very big training center for the Gujarati community at that time. So that's how it was presented. 2 weeks ago, I opened the play as Mere Piya Gaya Rangoon in Hindi, because there's a lot, again, a big audience that hasn't seen it in Gujarati. So here are some images from the play. As you can see, I don't know why it's... Let me try and magnify it a little bit for you. Yeah, that's better. Yeah. So you can see the painted backdrop at the back. Yeah, that's all painted. And this is Gokuldas Savaram Bhatia. A lot of research went into the costumes to create a kind of authenticity of the period, also dramatic. This is the introductory Ganesh Vandan and the beginning of the play. So as you can see, it's also traditional, but it's also very contemporary in the way masks are used in a non-traditional way rather than wearing them. But yet the Vandana is a very traditional Vandana. This is Bharat Ram in Bombay. So this was the style, that when the dhotis came, the waistcoats and the jackets, but the turbans remained. This is in Rangoon. Yeah, this is Bharat Ram in his village, in the more traditional style. That's his mother, Kunti Bhavi. Yeah. So these are some images from the play. Yeah. This play is currently being performed. If you see ads, etc., if you're interested, you come and see it. On the 29th, we're doing a performance in the open air at the race course. So that might be quite interesting for people to watch. It's a small space, 300 people, but try and make it if you can. It's interesting in the open air. We don't do enough open air performances in Bombay, so it might be fun. 29th, yeah. Yeah. So that's nearly, yeah.
Yeah, are you breaking even on this, even on the production costs and all that? How are you?
All theatre people are tremendous strategists, those who have survived. It's almost a guerrilla operation. You find ways to stay afloat. But no, most theatres companies don't make money. I would say, realistically, breaking even means that you pay everybody the correct market rates and then you have money left over. That's breaking even. We survive today breaking even without paying people correctly. So that's how we are breaking even. So it's not realistic. Right?
So it's not just producers and directors who are subsidizing theatre, it's actors, it's technicians, it's everybody who's involved in theatre subsidizing by not charging what they would normally, they would deserve to earn from this activity.
You see, in Bengal we've got this Jatra system.
Yeah, but Jatra is very good.
Soumitra Chatterjee, he participates in that.
Yeah.
And it's out of love, or Bhadra
Sahib. No, he earns lakhs, it's more than love.
He can get money on
lakhs.
Jatra
is very successful, hugely successful.
How are they economically? How are they?
Because they perform for 5,000 people at a time. So, you know, the economics of scale, it's also heavily culturally supported. It's a done thing, people watch, it has huge audiences. Though it's dwindling, even Jatra is going through hard times. But it's one of the forms. It's like Yakshagan in Karnataka. Yakshagan is tremendously commercially successful. You know, whether the money is shared equally is a different matter. But it is a success. You can't book a Yakshagana troupe.
5 years.
At least 5 years in advance you have to book them. They're booked up. Yeah. That's how popular. And that's great. It's great. I wish you were booked up 5 years in advance. I'm only booked up to 29. I don't know after that what will happen.
No, you see, Chavildas, I've seen plays of Girish Karnad have a.
Yeah.
And it was very successful. Aparna Sen was sitting on the. You know, there was no.
Aparna Sen paid 5 rupees to see that play. Jennifer Kapoor used to come to Chavildas regularly. She went, by the time she came, it was 7 rupees. There used to be about 30 people in the audience. So your collection was 210 rupees. Your hall rent was 600 rupees. Your ads cost you 400 rupees. The guy down the road who made upma for you so that after the show you could eat something before you went home,
yeah,
would charge 8 rupees a plate. So there was no way you made money. These are not fake figures, I'm telling you. Because I've done theater like that.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You mentioned about the censor board in the drama where Maharashtra and Gujarat, they have this kind of thing. It means every time you perform, you have to get the permission from the police department. Right? Now,
yeah.
What happens? They give the permission. And while performing, spontaneously, if somebody uses all language or do something, how?
I think you hit the nail on the head. Pre-censorship of live performance is absurd. You cannot control what I do on stage. I can't control what my actors do on stage. What the hell is censor board going to control anybody?
Like on TV,
yeah.
There is a wait period of 1 minute. This, you know, whatever you see, is already performed, but you see it after 1 minute. But during
lag, yeah.
That is what I have learned.
That's cricket and live events, not yeah, sure. But that's not because that's.
So,
that's for other reasons.
Do they send somebody who is
or are they editing before telecasting?
No, yeah, they do that on television. No. When coming back to theatre, no, they don't send anybody to watch this. They can. They have a right to, but usually they don't. Usually a lot of theatre companies will say, yes, we'll do this cut, we'll do that cut, and you perform exactly what you want to in the correct spirit of performance. Yeah, I won't tell you any more secret because I don't know who is in this audience. Let me tell you that we don't take the censor board seriously at all. They have done nothing to deserve our respect. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Sir, your contemporization of history was very profound. And I found glimpses of great genius in you.
Thank you.
And I'm really moved today, the way that you moved the episode of the mill. Yeah. Saga and the saga of the Warsaw killings.
Yeah.
But the point I want to make is with such profound movement behind, thinking behind this, why can't this be popularized? Like modern art is like gold today, you know? I think gold has lost its significance and modern art is now gaining.
Yeah.
So why can't this, is there a lack of marketing or what?
Yeah, I guess it's a lot of that. It's a lot of that.
Because the way
I found. But we must understand one thing, that, you know, let's be very honest about our society, right? In India, we don't give arts the kind of space that it needs. We are very short-sighted. I mean, why are we so happy about what Junoon is doing? For instance, why are we even doing this? Isn't this amazing? That, you know, on a Friday afternoon, giving up a lot of other stuff that you could be doing, including watching TV. Here we are sitting in this wonderful space talking theater. I can't even tell you how amazing it feels for people like us. I don't know, I'm sure that some of you are being stimulated by this. We need much more of this, and we don't. And it's a miracle when I talk to my contemporaries, my colleagues who do theatre in other countries, they cannot understand. They think it's a miracle that theatre happens in this country without any support. We do it because we feel it must be done. There is no support from the state or from largely society at large that says that no, what you guys do is important for us, so here is a space, please come and perform. In Germany, every city has its own theatre. I have spent some time in Freiburg, small city. The city of Freiburg gives Freiburg Theatre, 6 million euros every year just to produce theatre, dance and music. No questions asked. Here's the money, your job is to produce. And they produce it.
And the schools, the kids go to the
children's theatre.
What would you suggest we should do in India to come to there?
Well, I think support more, because you know, we don't have any expectations from the state. I mean, as a matter of right, we should be demanding. But in terms of, it is going to be a fight. But I think we completely support initiatives which are civil initiatives where people, civilian society, people like us gather, talk, spread the word. We just need to do this at a grassroots level. One of the projects that I work on, we created a new company called Tamasha Theatre. Which blank page will that we perform. What is the idea of performing poetry, really? I mean, it's obscure, right? As part of our national consciousness, who talks about poetry, right? But the idea is that, okay, we'll perform to 60 to 70 people, small groups of people, but make it so that there is a multiplier effect. There's a multiplier effect. And that's what we can hope to do. And I think you should just support whatever initiatives of this kind that you feel are worthwhile, because people are amazing in this country. We just do things because they need to be done.
Because I feel, sir, this art form is very necessary for the modern society, considering the stress that is there in the society. It's a great de-stressor,
Yeah, it's also a way of, understanding yourself and your world.
And understanding the contemporary times in perspective of history, as you said.
Sure.
How is the Prithvi sir doing with 5
Sorry, one second. You wanted to ask a question.
No, I just wanted to know which has been your most difficult moment in this journey, in the renowned as well, where you felt top of the world.
It would be difficult.
We work in an area where there is no guarantee of success as commonly defined. And I think my most difficult moment was about a year and a half ago. There was a play that I believed in very strongly and really worked very hard to put it together. And due to various reasons, they were completely out of one's control, because after all, you're dealing with human beings, it's lying, it's crazy. I mean, we take this so much for granted, but it's possible that you would, you have a performance and one of your actors breaks his or her leg, and the performance can't happen. That's the kind of tightrope we walk, right? So due to various reasons, the play didn't work the way I wanted it to work. There was a great sense of rejection by not just audience, but also by people I trusted and believed in, but I knew that what we had done was not what we had imagined, and that was a very low moment. And the only way that I know how to fight something like that is to then fight back and do it all over again. So 8 months later, I rebid the play, and this time it worked, and I would say that was a high for me. So
I'm told it's 500 rupees for a key. And that 500, is it a break even? I'm told it's still a house.
No, 500 rupees is not fixed. It depends on what. When you see a play of mine, it's 300. When you see a Nasiruddin Shah, you pay 500. So it depends on what you charge.
Why Prithvi is not going anywhere? Like, those dramas are not coming to suburbs, other suburbs.
Oh! Like Ghatkopar, we brought Bhagupyumir to Bhuri Behl and to all the other theatres, but there's a circuit. If I brought a Hindi play here, do you think he would come to watch?
All the dramas performed in Prithvi are not coming to any suburbs.
Because it's the kind of plays that need smaller audiences. We don't feel confident to come to a big theater and then have 600 people come, and then we make a huge loss because theater rents are expensive. So I rather make small losses over 6 shows rather than a big loss in one show and then break my back.
The infrastructure that Prithvi actually offers a infrastructure that works financially as well as theater needs wise. Are there any other theaters that offer that?
To some extent,
but otherwise the cost of doing theater, the cost of doing theater in existing halls is really way too high. So there's also a lack of an infrastructure that understands the needs of theater. I mean, there's a lot of in the environment that Sunil is describing. There are a lot of things that are off key, and they all you have infrastructure that doesn't understand what that art form needs, either financially or in terms of just setup.
Yeah, we could do a 3-hour session just on the economics of theater. Don't get it, it's very complicated. No, seriously, I know why you're asking me, and I understand, I appreciate that. Okay, I think we have time for just one or two more questions. Yeah.
I wanted to know how you've seen audiences change over
time?
The course of your experience in the theater industry. And I suppose the second part of that question is, do you feel that the theatre industry, the producers, as you say, have responded to a change in audience? Do you see that happening or has happened or not at all?
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. It's very dynamic. There are many, many audiences coexisting in the city. It's just crazy. You can define the different language audiences. Gujarati theatre has a very clearly defined kind of audience. I'm generalizing, but still. Marathi theatre has a very different kind of audience. Okay, Hindi theatre, whose language is it? I don't know. Okay, but those who subscribe to the idea of Hindi in terms of the fact that they come from the north, then that's a different kind of audience. Numerically, the audience has changed dramatically. I mean, very often in Chabildas, as Dutta was talking, quite often there were more of us on stage than in the audience. And it seemed like cool. That's how it is. We didn't care. 8 people watching the play. Oh, we had 42 people today. Great. You know, that kind of thing. Today, many, many more people are watching theatre. And that's great. That's great. We have a great number of young people watching our theatre. So that's very exciting for us. But one of the crises facing the Gujarati theatre is that its audience is aging. Young people, young Gujaratis are just not watching Gujarati plays. Marathi. Not enough young people watching Marathi theatre. Okay, their audiences are aging. With aging audiences, you also become conservative because, it's an older audience, right? We're used to a certain thing. So, it's an interesting question. Not enough of us address the whole idea of audience dynamics. Second part of your question, it's a serious problem. There are several companies that I can tell you about who have not changed according to the changing taste and audience, and as a result have become anachronisms. Okay, they are losing out rapidly and they're just unable to understand what the new audience wants. And I'm not saying this in the way that you have to pander to audience taste, not from that point of view. But times have changed. Storytelling has changed. The way people receive ideas, images has changed. Okay, you have to change accordingly. If you hold on to something in the past, it's not going to work. And yes, that is a problem.
Just one more question.
Yeah. The way I see it is it's essentially about storytelling. And theatre possibly is one of the mediums. So, I wanted to know, have you ever, across so many years, come across cinema for you personally as a creative person, writing, direction, actor, and what's your take on it? I mean, I believe that cinema is a lot more open today, and in terms of storytelling and in terms of audience receiving it, there is a lot more scope to do better work. So, what's your take there?
Okay, I'll answer this very briefly because it's a very complex question. I have worked in cinema in all the capacities you mentioned. I've written for cinema, I've acted in cinema, I've been part of direction in cinema, so I've been quite close to cinema. And with some wonderful directors who were very big in their time. But interestingly, cinema just does not interest me at all. At all. I barely watch 3 films a year. Okay? It just doesn't grab me. I mean, when I'm in the theatre, I'll enjoy it, but I will not feel, oh God, I can watch a movie. Okay, so that's out. It just does not interest me. But I'm also very connected to young cinema makers who were young perhaps a few years ago, not perhaps a new generation. And I've also seen how difficult cinema is, how difficult it is to do independent cinema. Alright? Multiplex cinema is not necessarily independent cinema. The kind of margins I have in the theatre to do exactly what I want to do. And I'm not saying this in some strange egoistic way, okay? But if I feel that sex, morality, censorship has to be done as a play, I have the means, I have the space to do it. And I will make sure that it runs for 3 years and not for 3 days. It's in my hands. Okay? In cinema, it's not like that. The money stakes are very high, the stakes are generally very high. There are many elements that are not in your control, whether it's distribution, this, that, or the other. Young directors who have wanted to have an independent voice have had to compromise, or if not compromise, go through so much stress that they have had breakdowns, because it's a cruel system, it's a difficult system. And hats off to anybody who can break the system. I have absolute admiration. I don't think I have that strength. So theatre is my medium.
Excuse me. This drama and all those things, how important all the critics plays? They give their review on this, this thing. If you read three different critics, they have a different viewpoint.
Yeah.
And so depending upon their thing, people will go for a movie or drama or something. Yeah. So how true are they? Or something else to
do? Well, it's a point of view. It's a point of view. So you have to treat it as a point of view.
Not as a minimalism.
No. And I really don't worry too much about that. I'd be very happy to have a good critique of my play, but most of the... We don't really have serious doubts.
It affects the audience.
Yes, it does, unfortunately it does, but people come regardless, you know, so that's good, yeah.
Do you have a place on CD so that, you know, you can...
You don't watch live. Okay, I think we should come. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much.
Thank you.